Hello, everyone. This is Bobbin Threadbear, and welcome to The Longest Journey. Now, it says 1999 there in the corner, but it came out in the year 2000 in America. Now, what you're looking at here is an upscaled version of Longest Journey. I doubled the pixel size to improve the graphics a bit. Also, because this is the only way I've been able to capture the cutscenes. Now, the upscaling has resulted in a few issues, some artifacting, pixel trails. I've done what I can to minimize it, and trust me, it could have been a lot worse than it is. But, this is still the best graphics you can expect out of the game. So, please bear with any glitches you spot.
So, you've come to hear me tell a story, have you?
If you please, we would love to hear one of your stories. You have seen so much. You have lived so long.
Oh, so good of you to remind me of my age, child. No, don't worry. I am an old woman, but I've lived a long and fulfilling life, and I do have stories to tell. Which story would you like to hear?
A true one. A true story.
All my stories are true, child. There are enough fairy tales in the worlds already. There's no need for me to make up more, believe me.
Tell us the story of the balance, then.
You want the story of the balance? Oh, that's a long story, child. And not one I'd venture to tell at this hour. But perhaps I could tell you a story that I heard a long time ago. A story that became a crucial turning point in the history of the balance. And that set in motion wheels that to this day are still turning.
Please, yes, that does sound like a story we'd like to hear.
Very well. This story, like all good stories, begins where it ends, in a tower, in a realm that is no more.
So, a couple things you should expect from this game. First of all, there's some brief male nudity coming up, just don't want you to get surprised by that. But this is a very slow-paced game compared to the action games I've played previously. There's a lot of talking. I'll be doing a lot of looking around at stuff, listening to people, so, you know, don't expect any stunning action sequences. I mean, it does get exciting, of course, it's just a lot of that excitement comes through in spoken stories. That's what you should expect. A lot of talking. A lot of good voice acting, which is essential for a game with a lot of talking. Also, it's a good story. It's got good backgrounds, although the 3D animation leaves something to be desired. I'll just shut up and let you enjoy the atmosphere now. That can't be good.
Oh,
Welcome to the future. The city of New Haven. There actually is a New Haven, Rhode Island, although I don't think that's the city this game is talking about. There's also a New Haven back in England, Wales. This is in America, so. Or at least it was.
Don't tell me I'm dreaming again. You know, for once, just once, it would be nice to have a decent night's sleep without waking up screaming from a bad dream at 4 a.m. It's a pristine and picture-perfect dawn. It's a pristine...
Except for that giant cloud.
There's a storm heading this way. Even the weather sucks in my dreams. I feel so charmed. Storm's coming. You know, that should really have been my cue to wake up. Postcard pretty.
It's got a ways to go before it reaches you.
I'm in my undies. That's so not appropriate.
So, our protagonist's name is April.
What's happening? Oh, perfect. I guess if I don't do something to save that egg, I'll suffer 7 years of bad karma or something. Lucky thing the egg got caught between those roots. It's a long way down. Looks reptilian, but it can't be. It's much, much too big and... I don't much care for reptiles. Lucky thing the egg got caught between those roots. It's a long way down.
Wonder if I can reach it. Looks like you can.
Did that sound come from the egg? Boy, that's some chick! I don't think I can get a good grip on it. It's too big and slippery, and I might drop it by accident.
Enough reach, not enough grip. By the way, welcome to the prologue.
It's a nest, padded with large scales, very large scales. For some strange reason, I have a feeling I should get the hell out of here before the tenants return.
I want to do something about that egg first, though.
It's a nest, padded with... This is interesting. I've never seen a scale this size before. I'll keep it as a souvenir. It's a large, slick, and somehow disturbingly reptilian scale. I'm an artist, not a botanist. But I'm pretty certain this tree is dead, or close to it. It's as dry as a bone. It'd probably snap right off in a second.
Maybe we should leave it be for now. But yeah, welcome to the prologue. This is basically your tutorial for how this game is gonna work.
Something happened to this rock quite recently, and it probably altered the course of the stream. Hey, maybe that's why the tree's dying. Something happened to this rock quite...
That would make sense.
Something happened to this rock...
I clicked on this...
Fresh... Something happened...
What the hell?
Something happened to this rock... Fresh mountain water.
I missed the first dialogue for the stream. Yeah. Maybe we could scoop some up for the tree. Give it a little more life. Not much we can do about the egg right now.
I'll lose my balance and fall if I have to hold the scale like this. I need something to support it with.
Well, hey. Maybe that branch will come in handy for that.
I'm an artist.
Oh. Oh, the suffering we must endure.
What?
Why do you take such pleasure in torturing us?
Torturing you? Who are you?
We are the voice of all trees, the spirit of wood and leaf.
You're a talking tree?
No, a tree does not talk. At least not in your tongue. The tongue of trees is the language of wood, root, and leaf.
Who are you then?
Like we said, we are the voice of all trees. Whenever an injustice is done, we must speak for the tree if we are present.
It's the branch. I shouldn't have broken the branch off.
Oh, what does it matter anyway? There is nothing more to be done for us. We are simply here to provide comfort in the final passing to Earth.
We? I only see one of you.
We are one with our host, as we are all one spirit, but legion.
Yeah, thanks for clearing that up.
We do not expect you to understand. You are human.
Interesting that the face is not over the tree's face down there.
What happened to the tree?
Oh, the pain. As the battle raged, we...
Battle?
Between the mother and Black Chaos. She was only protecting her child, but it would not back down. And the force of their battle shook the mountain. The brook that fed us was led astray, and without water, we began to wither and die.
What's the deal with the egg?
Egg? What egg? Oh, of course, the child. Whenever the mother was absent, we were entrusted with the safety of the child. But now, withered and without strength, we can do nothing to help. We have failed the mother, and we despair. Our shame knows no bounds.
Who are you again?
We are the wood spirit. We come to all trees in the hour of great need to provide comfort and aid in the passing to Earth, and to give a voice to those who suffer. Our time is running out as we speak. The passing to Earth is about to begin. Leave us now.
What about the egg?
Oh, it is too late. Without sustenance, we do not have the strength to bring it safely home. We have failed. And the Earth will know our shame for all time to come.
Are you always this glum?
We are here because it is too late. The passing has begun. Leave us. Please.
Isn't there anything I can do to help?
Oh, we do not expect a human to come to our aid.
Lose the attitude, okay? Just tell me if there's anything I can do.
It is futile. We need water, but there is none. Not after the brook changed course.
I'll find a way. Don't panic.
We do not panic. Unlike you, we accept our destiny. If, however, against all odds, you do succeed, we will carry the child safely back into its nest. Do not make a foolish attempt on your own. It would spell certain misery.
So like I said, this is basically a tutorial, so it has you do all the things you can do.
It's the withered limb of a dying tree. I feel so guilty. I really do.
Like, combine items.
I think I just made a funnel. Cool! I'm so proud of myself.
And then using objects in the world around you.
It's a funnel. Granted, it's primitive, but it's handcrafted and I used only organic ingredients.
Which, as you can see, makes the items glow when something can happen.
This should do the trick.
There, see? Told you that was his head.
Oh.
Surprisingly fast turnaround time, though. I suppose this is some sort of fantasy realm. With talking trees and all that, you know.
Talk about instant rehab. Hello? Hello?
Leave us be.
Are you okay?
We find our strength returned, and so we have no time for idle conversation. We must drink and rejoice.
Aren't we forgetting something?
Hush, listen. The song of ancient wood. Is it not sweet?
Sweet, definitely. Yeah, the baby's probably ready to boogie down as well.
The baby. Oh, the egg. Thank the earth. We almost forgot.
Uh-oh.
Oh, good. It did catch the egg.
That? Uh-oh.
It is you. You have come.
You know me?
April, daughter, I have been waiting for you.
Waiting? Why?
Because it begins here, with you. As it always has.
What do you mean?
The breach and the mending. The pain and the joy. The end of the old and the dawn of the new. A different world. I am the mother of what is. But you, you are the mother of a future that may yet be.
How will I know? How will I know what to do?
I will guide you. And I will protect you as much as I can. But in the end, you are on your own.
I'm afraid.
You always were, my child, my daughter.
This is probably not a good thing.
What she said, or that roar? Or both? Both. So ends the prologue.
Must have been tossing and turning all night. So hot in here, too. No wonder I keep having these weird dreams. I've basically been simmering in my own sweat every night this past week. Doesn't look like it's gonna cool down anytime soon, either. It's another sunny day in Newport.
Newport. That's what I meant. And that is the name I looked up.
Well, it's a good thing the studio's got proper air conditioning. I promised myself I was going to spend most of the day working, and I don't intend to break that promise. Not this time.
Well, looks like we just got some new inventory.
My cash card at the moment is really quite useless. There can't be more than a dollar or two left in it. April Ryan, you have got to get past yourself. It's kind of unsettling to be so aware of myself all the time.
Now we have a full name for April.
It's been too hot to sleep with a cover. So I don't. I don't need to make my bed. It's been too hot to sleep with a cover. I had to borrow some posters from the cafe, because I just can't afford to buy any of my own. When I think about it, that's so depressing. I got those posters from the cafe.
Well, starving student.
I'm not good at taking care of living things, but this plant's doing just fine despite months of neglect. I'm not good...
Is it secretly plastic?
Nice view, if you're into brickwork.
I like how the sound changed.
Spiky. It's a seagull. The poor guy looks quite hungry. Whatever those pipes are spewing out, I know one thing for sure, it ain't water. I still haven't figured out what runs through the canals in Venice, but I'm sure it can't be water.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty clear.
It's a rubber ducky, helplessly trapped under that rusty old grill.
This is a cyberpunk future.
It's a clothesline.
What? That sounds useful. Or, never mind.
I don't know what that chain's for, but it's connected to some kind of mechanism at the bottom of the canal.
Looks like we can only just rattle the chains right now. That's all we can do on this screen, so... I wonder if it's haunted with the door open or shut.
The wardrobe is actually made of real wood, and not that synthetic crap that makes me sneeze and itch all over.
Allergies.
The wardrobe...
What have we got?
Alright, so my wardrobe's sort of chic deficient, but I can't afford to be cutting edge. Useful, practical, and cheap is my shopping mantra. It's a bunch of drawings I drew when I was a kid. I don't even know why I brought them here. They mean absolutely nothing to me. I could only carry one suitcase with me when I left home. There was so much I would have loved to bring, but c'est la vie. At least it was a clean break with my past. I guess when all my hard work starts paying off, I'll get a house and fill it with all kinds of new junk. The past, who needs it? My suitcase. Empty cardboard box. That's so not interesting.
Not completely empty.
It's Constable Guybrush, my toy ape. He doesn't much like being called monkey. In addition to being an ape, Constable Guybrush plays drums in the Toyburg Police Corps marching band. Go figure.
That has to be a reference to Monkey Island, by the way. Guybrush is... They made up the name for that game.
Constable Guybrush is a strange hybrid between man, ape, and musician. In addition to being an officer of the law, of course. It's Constable Guybrush. I think one of his eyes is falling out.
Well, let's grab it.
The eye came loose. Poor Constable Guybrush. It's a great, big eye on a spring. Sorry, Guybrush, but I need to borrow your eye for a while.
Well, needs a bit of a strong word.
It's a wind-up mechanism.
Hey, you! Yeah, you! Hands up! Spread your legs! And do the monkey!
Mildly amusing, but irritating as hell. I'll shut him up now.
How weirdly specific.
Monkey see, monkey do. Well, not without this he won't. Shelves. That's my desk, so, theoretically, that's where I'm supposed to do my work. I think my muse has departed me for greener pastures, though, because lately, inspiration's been fleeting at best. I worry about the exhibition coming up in 2 weeks. This is the net result of my work. A pile of nothing. And it's not even a big pile of nothing. It's just a chair. It's a picture of me and my friends. It's a picture of Charlie, Emma, and me, in Florence Park. Marcus took it about a month ago, before it got real hot. It's a picture of Charlie...
Can't interact with the lamp.
I'm part of the should be reading more but life's too short generation. We embrace our illiteracy. The last book I read was How to Seduce the Man of Your Dreams. Now, if I can just find a man to dream about, I'll be all set. Books. I don't read much, but I believe it's important to maintain an intellectual facade. My on-again, off-again diary. We've had a turbulent relationship, her and I. Dear diary, note to self. Dreams of talking trees and dragons aside, it's still no excuse for talking to inanimate matter in the real world. So quit it.
Well, just take it instead. By the way, you are required to have this diary, even though it serves no inherent use.
I've been keeping a diary intermittently since I was 5 years old. Not the same one, of course. I started this one, I think, April of this year.
The way they make you take it.
There's a loose sheet of paper in here. Hey, it's my timesheet from the cafe. I completely forgot I put it in here. Good thing I found it, because I'm broke.
It's because they put a plot critical item inside of it.
It's my diary. It's a list of the hours I worked this past week at the cafe.
Can't even do a close-up of the diary anymore.
That's my work. It's supposed to be a portrait of my life study teacher, but I think he might disagree.
Oh yeah, and that's another thing you can do. But yeah, pick it up so that you can go here. Read April's diary. Now, you can pause the video if you want to read it yourself, but basically it provides some background for April. She's got a very bad relationship with her father, so she left without telling her family anything to come here, to come to an art school in what is called Venice, the Venice District, which is near the art school in Newport. She has two brothers. She has a mother who ignored April's problems with her father. And she has at least one friend here whom she grew up with, who pointed her in this direction in the first place. But that's enough for one video. A new LP comes with a new set of corners. This time, I'm casting a pretty wide net. I mean, the game is all about magic and science fiction. High fantasy juxtaposed with a cyberpunk future. I can't pick one or the other. I have to cover both. So this time around, the four corners will represent four sides of the speculative fiction umbrella. There's science fiction and fantasy, of course, but then there's also magical realism. That genre is a bit harder to place, but it represents a setting where something is clearly not normal, but you don't have magicians casting spells everywhere. I think like a setting where everyone is a talking animal, but it's otherwise just modern society. The fourth corner is alternate history, the genre that explores what the world would look like if history didn't go the way it did in real life. Finally, there's the portal episodes, the grab bag, where protagonists travel through portals, either literal or figurative, and journey into a world that is not their own. Portal episodes are going to be my personal picks, while the rest are patron requests. And since I don't think it's any spoiler to say that the prologue was no dream, we'll be starting things off with portals. It's a bit of an unusual pick. The movie I'm looking at is Enchanted, released by Disney in 2007. The story about the story. Disney is a studio with a history of making risky decisions. Snow White was a risky move, the first ever feature-length animation that took an immense amount of work and effort back in 1937. 1940's Fantasia was an experiment, a series of animated music videos that's well-regarded now, but flopped when it originally came out. In 1950, Disney, an animation studio, created a live-action Treasure Island movie. In 1955, Disney opened a theme park of all things, in an era where theme parks were dead, and now it's the most famous of its kind in the world. More recently, you have the gamble of making a shared cinematic universe based on Marvel properties, and we all know how well that's worked out for them. Still, Disney is also a massive corporation, and big corporate entities tend to have, let's call it, institutional inertia. If it ain't broke, why fix it, right? If people love something yesterday, they'll obviously love it tomorrow. And so you get stuff like the Disney princesses, the canon of Disney animated leading ladies who may or may not have had personalities in their original films, but are reduced to standing there and looking pretty in their signature dresses to sell dolls and other Disney products to little girls worldwide. Now I'm telling you all of this to give you some perspective for the story and the analysis. Well, it's about time I start explaining the movie now. Enchanted began life as a script written by Bill Kelly, bought by the Disney studio Touchstone Pictures in 1997. It was a parody of Disney princess movies at that point, but it was also a vulgar teen comedy in the style of Risky Business and American Pie, and I mean vulgar in the nicest way here. But then the script went through a few rewrites, as is common in Hollywood, to make it more Disney-friendly, and then it got lost in development hell for about 8 years, which is also common in Hollywood. In 2005, Disney settled on the director and the writer who would finally make the damn film. Kevin Lima, director who worked on animated movies like A Goofy Movie and Tarzan, and Bill Kelly again. Except by this point, raunchy teen comedies were out of fashion, and so Kelly worked with Lima to create something a little more respectful, family-friendly. The two storyboarded the whole movie together. Disney gave the go-ahead, and the movie began production. To play the leading lady, Lima brought in Amy Adams, an actor and comedian whose first major role was in Catch Me If You Can, but whose breakout hit would be Enchanted. She was over 30 at the time, a bit old for this kind of role, but she was absolutely committed to the part, to the character, and that is her singing during the movie's musical numbers. The role of leading man went to Patrick Dempsey, who is 8 years older than Adams, and was at that point most famous for playing Dr. Derek Shepherd on the hit new TV show Grey's Anatomy. You also have comedy actor James Marsden as the second leading man, Broadway star Idina Menzel as the second leading lady, and the future Queen Elsa of Frozen, and Susan Sarandon as the evil Queen Nerissa. There are a few other famous names on the cast list, but I'll get into that later. Enchanted was a reasonably big hit when it came out, and on a budget of $85 million, it made back $341 million at the box office. Its deconstruction of the Disney myth made it a big hit with critics, and at the same time, it was still very accessible to Disney's primary audience. It's a good family film, in other words. It also has some impressive effects, including 13 minutes of pure 2D animation, and a lot more CG than you'd expect from a mid-aughts comedy. But now I think it's about time to discuss the story. The movie begins inside the Disney castle, with a book like Sleeping Beauty. The narrator, incidentally, is Julie Andrews, aka Mary Poppins. Anyway, the setup is that the evil Queen Nerissa married into the throne and has a stepson, Prince Edward. If Edward finds his true love, kisses her, and marries, Nerissa will lose her claim to the throne. So she has her henchman Nathaniel keep him busy hunting trolls instead of flirting with girls. Unfortunately for the queen, there happens to be a lovely young woman named Giselle living with her animal friends in a cottage in the woods. She's been dreaming of her true love, literally, and she puts together a dummy with a blue outfit and sparkling blue eyes. She then breaks out into a song about true love's kiss, and the whole damn forest acts as her chorus. We then transition to the blue-eyed Prince Edward and Nathaniel, as the prince catches yet another troll. Edward is starting to think that there's more to life than just troll hunting, and when he hears Giselle singing, he gallops towards her voice. So to stop him from finding anyone, Nathaniel unties the troll, and antics ensue. But that plays right to Edward's strengths, and between him and Giselle's talking chipmunk sidekick, Pip, the troll is defeated, and Giselle sings a duet with Prince Edward. The two propose to marry the next morning, which is basically the worst-case scenario for Queen Nerissa. The next morning, Giselle is in her massive wedding dress, which she apparently made with the help of a small zoo's worth of animals. On the way to the chapel, Nerissa shows up disguised as an old hag, and she takes Giselle to a wishing well and shoves her in. Turns out it's actually a portal to another dimension, a place where there are no happily ever afters. And as Giselle transitions from animation to live action, the movie transitions from the ratio used by Disney's original animated movies to the more common CinemaScope ratio. Giselle climbs out of a manhole in Times Square, New York City, and she's quickly overwhelmed by the crowds, the lights, and the fast-moving vehicles. Incidentally, that dress Adams is wearing weighed 45 pounds. She follows the flow of foot traffic into the subway, and somehow ends up at Bowery Station, which is about 3 miles to the south and in a much meaner neighborhood. Meanwhile, Robert Philip, named after Prince Philip from Sleeping Beauty, is representing Mrs. Banks in a divorce. She gets her name from the Banks family in Mary Poppins. I could do this for basically every character, by the way, so I'll just skip all but the big references from here on, and you should just assume that everything is a reference from here on out. Like how that legal assistant there is Jodie Benson, the voice of Ariel from The Little Mermaid. Robert has a young daughter named Morgan, and he has a long-term girlfriend, Nancy Tremaine, whom he plans to propose to soon. Now, Robert raises his daughter without any nonsense like fairy tales or true love, and I think you guys know where this is going already. Anyway, it starts to rain, and Giselle gets so desperate for something recognizable that she confuses a fancy casino billboard for an actual castle and tries to get in. That's where she is when Robert and Morgan's taxi stops nearby. Now, Morgan loves fairy tales, despite her dad's attempts, and so she gets out to wave at Giselle. Giselle slips and falls, and, much like Prince Edward, Robert catches her. Just with a lot more flailing and bruises, like how that would actually go. Giselle seems helpless, and it's about to rain some more, so Robert takes her home to dry off and warm up a bit. She explains her backstory on the way to Robert's apartment. Morgan takes to her immediately, but Robert wants her gone as fast as possible, until he sees her sleeping peacefully on the couch and changes his mind. The next morning, Pip has told Prince Edward about what happened, and both jump into the magical well. Edward is fine on the other side and brandishing a sword, but while Pip can move around like he normally does, he can only speak in squeaks. Squeaks provided by the director, Kevin Lima, incidentally. The two make a scene, and then run off. As for Giselle, when she wakes up, she decides to repay Robert's hospitality by cleaning up the place. She calls for all her forest friends, but let's just say some Manhattan animals answer her call. Still, she makes lemons out of lemonade, and she puts the pigeons and rats to work with the happy working song. Morgan wakes up in time to see all of this, and so she drags her dad out of bed. Of course, he's less than pleased to see his apartment full of vermin, but there's not much he can say when he finds Giselle in the shower, and two pigeons fetch her a towel. And naturally, this is when Robert's future fiancé appears, so misunderstandings ensue, and Nancy storms out. Robert then finds out that Giselle made a blue summer dress out of his curtains, so he's pretty angry with her at this point, an emotion Giselle has only heard of before now. Meanwhile, Queen Nerissa is unhappy now that Edward's gone after Giselle, so she sends Nathaniel to New York to keep Edward distracted. And it doesn't take him long to find the prince, since Edward is fighting a city bus, and the driver is just about ready to kick his ass. Back with Robert, he has no idea what to do with Giselle at this point, so he brings her to work and asks Jodie Benson to watch her. In the meantime, Nathaniel finds his way into a kitchen somehow, and Nerissa sends him 3 poison apples to use on Giselle. Pip sees this happen, but he can't do much to warn Edward, since he can't talk on this side. Back with Robert, he's made some progress on the Banks' divorce, but then Giselle compliments the Banks on their relationship, and they take it as some weird new hardball tactic and leave in a huff. Robert has had enough, so he hands Giselle some money and tells her to figure out the rest herself. Money has second thoughts immediately, and then he chases after her when he sees Giselle hand all of his money to a random old woman in Central Park. They start talking about their love life after that. While Giselle has known Edward for a day and wants to marry him, Robert has been with Nancy for 5 years without proposing. That's when Giselle breaks out into the big showstopper, That's How You Know. The whole of Central Park gets involved, much to Robert's confusion, including a set of elderly dancers who happen to be veterans of Mary Poppins. In the process, Giselle convinces Robert to send Nancy an invitation to a themed ball to make up for the morning's confusion. She fails to convince Robert to sing or dance, and Edward spots but fails to reach Giselle. By the time the song ends, Nancy accepts the invitation. Edward, Nathaniel, and Pip regroup at a rundown hotel. Edward starts flipping through TV channels and comes across a soap opera featuring Paige O'Hara, the voice of Belle from Beauty and the Beast. The TV thoroughly distracts Edward, but Nathaniel heads out to do more mischief, and Pip follows him. Robert and Giselle go to an Italian restaurant that evening, a restaurant named after the title song from Lady and the Tramp. Giselle realizes that Robert basically took her on a date based on his description from earlier, but of course, he denies it. Plus, Morgan's with him. It's at this point that Robert explains that his wife left him and Morgan, hence why he's so down on fairy tale love. Then Nathaniel shows up with an appletini, but Pip knocks it out of Giselle's hands and causes a small panic by being a rodent in a restaurant. Nathaniel apparently kills Pip, but he only gets knocked out. On the bright side, the incident gets Giselle an interview on the local news, so Edward sees her and figures out where she is. He then spends the rest of the night knocking on every door in Robert's apartment building, including one with a pregnant Judy Kuhn, the singing voice of Pocahontas. This gives Giselle and Robert enough time to argue about whether Edward's really coming, and Giselle has her first experience with being angry. Oddly enough, this makes her happy, and there's a moment when they almost kiss, but don't. They do realize what almost happened, however. The next morning, Giselle makes another light dress out of a sheet, and Prince Edward finally finds them. However, Giselle is having second thoughts about Edward, and to stall for time, she asks him on a date. Still, she and Edward say their goodbyes to Robert and Morgan, while Queen Nerissa decides to take matters into her own hands. And then it turns out that the Banks have decided to reconcile after what Giselle said. Sure, it might not work, and it could all go up in flames again, but love is worth a second chance. Giselle and Edward spend the day exploring New York, but when Edward wants them to go home, Giselle comes up with one last reason to stay. The King's and Queen's Ball, the same one Robert and Nancy will be going to. To prepare for it, Giselle finds Morgan, Morgan gets Robert's gold card, and the two go on an emergency shopping spree. It's now time for the big ball and the big finale. Giselle arrives in a very modern outfit that takes Robert's breath away. Then, conveniently, the MC tells the guests to dance with someone they didn't bring with them. So, Edward and Nancy pair up, and, like I said, you guys know where this is going. Robert even ends up dancing and singing to Giselle, two things he refused to do earlier. Still, the dance can't last forever. As Giselle mournfully watches Robert with Nancy, Nerissa shows up in her old hag disguise. And I'd like to add that that is a very thorough makeup job on Susan Sarandon. The hag tells Giselle that she'll forget all about her cares and worries with just one bite of her magic apple. But of course, when she takes a bite, she passes out. Nerissa drops her disguise and tries to escape with Giselle, but Edward stops her. The queen then tries to pass off her actions as helping, but Nathaniel is tired of being her worthless toady and spills the beans on the whole operation. Edward believes him, and fortunately the poison is only fatal upon the stroke of midnight. That means there's time to cure her with true love's kiss. Because of course that's the cure. Did you expect anything less? Edward gives it a shot, but nothing happens. And come to think of it, Robert's eyes are also blue. Plus, he's wearing the blue outfit Giselle created at the beginning of the movie. Nancy gives Robert her permission, and he kisses Giselle. And then Giselle wakes up to the cheers of everyone around them. They all think this is part of some skit for the ball, by the way. Or at least they do until Nerissa turns into a damn dragon, grabs Robert, and bursts out through the window. Giselle grabs Edward's sword and runs after them, leaving behind one clear plastic slipper. The three climb to the top of the building, and with a little help from Pip, Giselle saves Robert, and Nerissa goes crashing to the ground, since her dragon form can't actually fly. Well, at least not in this dimension. And then, of course, Giselle catches Robert. They still need to get rescued off the roof, though. We then see what happens to all the characters during each of their ever-afters. On a whim, Nancy runs off with Edward and marries him in the animated realm. Giselle continues to use her animal friends to make dresses, specifically princess dresses, for little kids. Nathaniel stays in New York too, and writes a memoir/self-help book about his time with Nerissa. Pip writes his own book back home, and it's a big hit with all the forest animals. And as for Robert, well, he, Morgan, and Giselle live happily ever after. The analysis. The message of Enchanted is simple, but it's told in a complex way so that adults will remember why this message exists in the first place. The message is true love will win over all. And the reason we give that message to kids is not to protect them from the horrors of time and tragedy. The reason we adults say that is because we hope it'll be true. We hope that true love will conquer all. At least for us. At least for our lives, if not for the world. Here's the thing. The world sucks. But the world has always sucked. But the world is also amazing. And it has always been amazing. It's not a contradiction. It's not even the world's fault. It's us. It's the fact that people can have two different opinions on things and then extrapolate one of those opinions onto the world as a whole. We can go through a messy divorce and convince ourselves that love is an illusion. We can be sheltered from the world and convince ourselves that everything will always magically work itself out. We can then watch as two people with two very different opinions collide and realize that neither view is wholly right or wrong. People have more than one emotion, and the world around us is never completely predictable. That last point, I think, is the reason why the movie has that foreshadowing with the mannequin. Giselle and Robert are fated to be together, but neither of them truly realize this until that fate has become self-evident. Before then, they both think that they're fated, or at least obligated, to be with different people. But then events out of their control prove them wrong. So even if fate exists, and even if the world is completely deterministic, it is a supreme act of arrogance to assume that we, as humans, can correctly predict what fate has in store for us. Enchanted also offers a very feminist deconstruction of what I earlier called the Disney myth, although to be honest, calling it that is giving Disney a lot more credit than it deserves. What I'm referring to is the princess monomyth, the idea that a woman can, with little to no effort on her own part, get caught up in a conflict that will ultimately land her a handsome prince who will love and respect her forever after. All the woman has to do is stand there and look pretty and maybe do one or two little things, and everything will just fall into place for her. Disney gets credit for this myth, or at least for perpetuating it, because a lot of their animated movies draw on stories that even the original myths didn't invent this idea. People are lazy, and the whole one day my prince will come belief is the same reason people keep buying lottery tickets despite the astronomical odds of winning. We all want success, and we don't always want to work for it. But now here's the clever part. Enchanted deconstructs the form of the myth, the idea that the world will magically fall into place for you and you'll automatically live happily ever after, but it doesn't discount the motivation behind the myth. It doesn't say that your success will never come. What it says is you have to earn it. Think about what you want, think about how you can achieve it, and then do everything you can to get there. And if something unexpected happens along the way, there's nothing wrong with embracing it. Dreams do come true, but it may not be the exact dream you came up with, and it'll only happen if you work to make it so. Incidentally, I don't think Disney has done a classic-style princess story since before Enchanted came out. Pocahontas had to save John Smith, and Mulan is a very intentional departure from the norm. The Princess and the Frog is only vaguely based on the original story. Tangled features a very proactive princess, at least when she gets going. And Frozen has its own deconstruction of the overnight lovers trope. And then with Moana, there is zero romantic interest between the two leads. So while the Disney Princess lineup remains, this idea that you can just passively wait for your dreams to come true is fading away. I mean, there are still stories coming out every year that perpetuate the myth of the passive protagonist, and the male version, by the way, is the Chosen One myth, where destiny promises that you'll win just because you were born. But then, of course, people keep buying lottery tickets. So thanks for joining me for the start of a new LP. I hope I'll see you next time when I review a famous 90s and aughts TV show with Star in the name, but not Trek.